Like me, do you often wish you could listen to Blood on the Leaves and Down with the Sickness and the guy from Corn Scatting all at the same time? Do you wish that Gangnam Style was a stand-up bit instead of a song? Do you want to hear all the rappers you love just saying the word anime? Welcome to SoundClown. SoundClown is the name bestowed upon so-called weird SoundCloud, where instead of uploading your hot new trap beat or hilarious comedy podcast, you upload this.
Open Gangnam Style.
Or this. Or this. You may simply think of these as mashups, and I can understand your confusion, but these are not mashups. Although some of them sound like mashups. Like the Macarena. But the purpose of SoundCloud is not the same as Danger Mouse's The Grey Album, or the Kleptones' Yoshimi Battles the Hip Hop Robots, or Dean Gray's American Edit. Mashups create full songs from existing pieces. Maybe it's Boulevard of Broken Dreams and Wonderwall, or maybe it's Dashboard Confessional and Sage Francis.
Yelling at the megaphones, killing hard rocks, using carcasses as stepping stones. Had a promise that I'd stop holding my marches. The day that Chris Columbus got crucified in golden arches.
The result is a new whole. Sometimes it's misguided, like mashing up Dashboard Confessional and Sage Francis, but it is a complete and new song nonetheless. SoundClowns are not full songs. They're jokes or experiments or snippets of an idea that are more often than not under a minute long.
Six geese a-laying.
Five gold rings.
Five gold rings like I'm a shut.
And you turn off your iPhone. Careless whispers, I-fucking iPhones. Neck, ears, hand, legs, iPhones. Your pussy's too good, I need the iPhone. Your titties, let them out.
No one is going to confuse that with the Grey Album. The term SoundClown was first used by SoundCloud user Dick Soak, known on Twitter as Drugleap or LeVar Burzum, to describe his Biggie Wave remix, which to be clear is basically just a slowed down Ready to Die sample. SoundClown even has a few recurring memes. Macklemore is a popular one. There are actually two Macklecore compilation albums. They are mostly unlistenably insane.
Piss. 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 Piss.
The Seinfeld theme makes regular appearances, as does the work of mainstream DJs like Skrillex and Avicii. In fact, the deconstruction of contemporary EDM tropes defines some of the best SoundClowns.
New York, it's time to rewind.
Look at this photograph.
SoundClown creators definitely overlap with the weird Twitter and YouTube poop community. For a look at YouTube poops, you should definitely watch our Vaporwave episode. There is a link in the description, but as a confusing taste for right now, this is Big Beat Mario. These kind of sound collages can be traced back as early as 1956, when Dickie Goodman and Bill Buchanan released The Flying Saucer Part 1 and 2.
Would you tell our audience what would you do if the saucer were to land?
Duck back in the air!
Thank you.
This novelty record included 18 top 20 hits. It's like a 1950s girl talk.
Trans got the fuck with $40 in the club. Fucking up the game, bitch, it gets no love.
It's also an early example of the compositional style that would come to be known as plunderphonics.
Feeling,
Plunder phonics were defined by composer John Oswald in the 1980s, loosely encompassing any new musical work comprised entirely of previously existing samples, as practiced by artists like Oswald and Negative Land.
The letter U and the numeral 2.
Well, I was doing that. You know, all the kissing on the honey lips.
Plunder phonics, as a result, more often represent a consciously difficult style of composition, which is why I think that more than anything, sound clowns are basically internet folk music.
This land is your land, and this land is my land, from the California to the New York Island.
It's obvious that the Macarena doesn't bear much resemblance to the works of Bob Dylan, but at its heart, it carries on the traditions that we might otherwise ascribe to folk. Music carried down through generations, defining a culture or community, evolving through reinterpretation.
Damn, son, where'd you find this?
Just like folk music, sound clowns are non-commercial, and they fuse old and new culture. And since we no longer define the media we consume in the same narrow terms, it follows that sound clowns themselves would draw equally from 90s sitcoms and laptop DJs. I mean, we listen to music on a video platform, and I hate when people call me on my pocket telephone.
I just talked to Jesus. He said, what up, Jesus? I said, shit, I'm chill. Trying to stack these millions.
Sound clowns take all of that culture and, like a modern Woody Guthrie, use it to tell a new and honest story. And this is what is honest in 2014.
Somebody won't tell me the world is gonna roll me. I ain't the sharpest tool in the shed.
The more I think about it, the more sense this folk connection makes. Like, our ancestors had legends and we have Mario. They had Dylan and we have Skrillex. They had clogging and we have twerking. And now all of those folk traditions are combined into one clown ass stew. What do you think? Is sound clown internet folk music? Is that a completely insane sentence? Let me know what you think in the comments and be sure to subscribe for new episodes of This Exists every week. Be excellent to each other. Last week's episode was our celebration of having 100,000 subscribers, and we talked about the illustrious musical history of Sir Christopher Lee. Let's see some of the comments that you made that were cool. Tim Walker, along with many of you, pointed to Christopher Lee's military service, which we did not even touch on in that episode, but I encourage you to Google Christopher Lee and read the part of his Wikipedia page all about how he served his country and the world by being a Nazi hunter. The man literally hunted Nazis after World War II. He is like a cartoon of a cool person. It's a joke. Last week we touched on a lot of actors who have tried their hand at musicaling. Casey Jacobs, along with several of you, pointed out that it seems as if musicians, by and large, have an easier time transitioning into acting, with the exception of Sting in Dune, which is a terrible film and a terrible performance. But Casey himself points out Tom Waits and Will Smith as prime examples. Will Smith, of course, not even human. Too great of a talent to be born of this earth. And I think an interesting point was made that ultimately there's maybe more acting that goes into being a musician than musicianing that goes into acting. And that artists such as Will Smith and Tom Waits, who have spent a lot of time cultivating a compelling musical persona, find it easy to translate those skills onto the screen. As Hasselhoff, not so much luck. Anyway, I salute you, Will Smith, except that you're a Scientologist. It's weird. Steam user 123 offered a 50-50 comment with the notion that in a Celtic Frost shirt that I was wearing, I clearly listened to some damn fine metal, but that unfortunately I also look like a douchebag. Do you know what they say? Steam user 123 giveth, Steam user 123 taketh away. But thank you, because I care more about liking good music than looking or not looking like a douchebag. This week on Sam's Club, the thing that I'm the most excited about is not a book. It is, in fact, that The Newsroom is back on HBO, the best worst show ever made. It's like Troll 2, but serious and about 9/11, which is a dangerous combination. Anyway, if you watched the first episode of The Newsroom and you hate that show but can't stop watching it as much as me, please let me know what you think in the comments, because Oh my God, it's my favorite hate watch in the world. I can't wait, what's, man, it sucks. Okay, have a good week.